design, fabrication, and applications of rare earth metamaterials. Metamaterials are made of periodically arranged subwavelength metallic patterns that are able to couple to external EM waves. We often fabricate them on substrates that are transparent to terahertz wave. One of the most common structure we use is a speed green resonator, or the SRR. This structure resembles the traditional LC circuit. When interacting with light due to resonance, there appears to be a transmission dip in the spectrum, and this is so-called the LC resonance. With properly designed dimensions, then the resonant frequency can fall into the terahertz range. Note that LC resonance only appears when the incident polarization is across the gap. When it's parallel to the gap, then the surface part breaks into two symmetrical branches, and another resonance appears at a different frequency, that's a dipole resonance. This device is often used for terahertz filter or sensor to sense changes in the environment. As the structures are fairly large, often in micron scale, the devices are fabricated following a standard lithography, deposition of metal, and lift-off process. What we have innovated here was to do the process twice and to fabricate metal pattern on both sides of the substrate so as to extend their use as broadband terahertz filter. Previous attempts at designing broadband devices often shown SRR but turned to isotropic patterns such as closed rings, crosses, and metal patches. This is because, as we have seen, SRR are known to have sharp and narrow transmission dips and that are polarization sensitive. It is a pity that this SRR was not used in these works, even though they have been so very well studied as how to tune their resonant frequency, how they couple to each other, etc. Another thing is in these works is that they often stack multiple layers together to obtain broadband performance. That would mean precise alignment of the unit cell is required during the lithography step, as the coupling between these thin layers, often just a few micron thick, are the key factor at play here. What we proposed was to fabricate SRR patterns on both sides of a thick substrate, but rotate one side 90 degrees with respect to the other. The substrate needs to be comparable or narrower than the operating wavelength so as to purposely decouple the front and the back layer. This is not a stringent condition because the commonly used substrates, be it quartz, silicon, PET, or PDMS, they can easily meet this requirement. And now, since the two layers are not coupled, then the alignment of the unit cell is not required during fabrication. Here's the simulated spectrum for the device. So for the single layer device, like what we have said, there are two resonances corresponding to the two different polarized incidences. Whereas for the what we call here 0 degree and 90 degree, it refers to the one that's parallel to the gap and across the gap. And for the double layer device, then we can see for these two polarizations, the spectrum actually overlap, and a broad stop band is visible here. To understand why, we simulated the surface current. First, for the single layer device, we can see for the polarization that's parallel to the gap, then like we state, the current breaks into two symmetrical branches. And for the one that's across the gap, then the current is non-symmetrical and breaks into two branches up and down. For the double layer device, for a vertically polarized incidence at 0.8 terahertz, the front layer sees polarization parallel to its gap, so it behaves according to the black curve. It has a strong resonance at 0.8 terahertz. Almost all the lights were stopped before the front layer. Nothing goes to the back, so the back layer was not excited at all. As the frequency increases, the front layer becomes less and less effective, and more light goes to the back. and then the back will see light that's polarized across its gap. So it performs according to the red curve. Now at 1.1 terahertz, then the back was a very effective filter. So whatever comes through, the back there filters it out. Then for a horizontally polarized light, then it is filtered the same way, only in a reverse order. So at low frequency, the front layer looks according to the red curve. It is not that effective. More light goes through the back. Then the back works according to the black curve, filter it out. And at high frequency, the front layer stops it completely. So to sum up, these two layers complement each other and form a broad stop band together. They work as two filters connected in series. And since they are identical on the front and at the back, X polarized light is filtered just the same as Y polarized light, only in a reverse order. Now, with the principle fully understood, it is possible to design an ultra broadband. The key is to ultra broadband filter. The key is to find a structure that has alternating resonances over a long frequency range. From a study we did, which I will talk about shortly, we find that double SLR in this configuration, where the outer ring and the inner ring face oppositely to each other, they essentially resonate independently. So while the outer ring have two resonances at these frequencies corresponding to the differently polarized instance, and the inner ring have two resonances at frequencies a little further apart, the double SLR device, it inherits all these four resonances. So for the polarization parallel to its gap, it's got one resonance from the outer ring and one from the inner ring, and so as for the polarization across its gap. Now we have a structure that has alternating resonances at neighboring frequencies over a long frequency range. And the idea is the same, to pattern it on both sides of a substrate. And this method is versatile. We can use different substrates. So we fabricated the samples of a 1 millimeter thick quartz and a 100 micron thick PET. Now the PET sample is so thin, we can have both layers in focus here. We can clearly see the misalignment of the unit cell, and that is not the problem. And this is the mirrored spectrum for both samples. We can have a stop band as large as 1.4 terahertz. Following the idea, we came up with more designs, and we particularly came up with this design to study the effect of structure symmetry. So here we have a device with symmetrical unit cell, and one have non-symmetrical unit cell. So for the symmetric device, the results are quite as expected. So for single layer, two sharp resonances, for double layer, then we have a broadband filter. And if we look at the simulated E field distribution, the mechanism are also like just described. At low frequencies, one layer works, at high frequency, both layers work together. Now what's more interesting is that if we examine the each entry of the Jones matrix are in the form of Tij. So what Tij means is the transmitted level of J polarized light with an I polarized incidence. And here we have, if we look at this spectrum, that's for single layer device with symmetric unit cell. We have only non-zero Txx and Tyy. That means if you have an X polarized incidence, you only get X polarized light transmitted. The cross polarized transmission are suppressed to zero. And this is not the case if you look at the single layer device with asymmetric unit cell. We can have a significant non-zero Txy and Tyx which overlap. That means this device is able to induce cross-polarized transmission. And another thing to look is that if we check these two resonances, the spreads are not as strong as the symmetrical device. So if we just look at the spectrum then the structural characteristics of whether they are symmetrical, the structural characteristics, whether they are symmetrical or non-symmetrical, you can tell by just looking at the spectrum. But this is not the case for double-layer device. For double-layer device, for both devices, they can work as the broadband, the filter we talked about, and both of them suppress the cross-polarized transmission. So why is so? We look at the simulated E-field distribution again. Let's look at the double-layer device with asymmetric unit cell. So for a wide polarized instance, that's the one vertically, like said, the front layer now, the resonance wasn't strong enough. Originally, for symmetrical device, the front layer stops the light free. So now the resonance wasn't that strong. Some of the light still goes to the back. When it goes to the back, it changes its polarization to horizontal. And now the back layer would also see one that's parallel to its gap. So both layers see polarization parallel to the gap. And they work together at this resonance to stop the light. And so as for X polarized incidence at higher frequency. Next, I will talk about a simple way to fabricate PDMS device. The method is to treat a PET sample in oxygen plasma. So the charge trapped on the surface of the PET will start to repel the metal pattern on the surface. Also, the undercut of the PET will improve the transfer yield too. By bringing a PDMS substrate into contact with the treated PET sample, the metal can transfer We don't need to put a sacrificial layer on the PET material. So we need to improve the materials are made of the PDMS surface. And with this method, we tried out various patterns big and small. We also fabricate some medium substrates. And the overall yield to estimate it to be one of the most common. So the first thing we need with this method is to try out a PDMS problem. This structure is simple from the previous study. So we took when two of the PET single layer, there appears to be a transparent.
Inner ring. rate
to be different, comparable, or better than the operating wavelength, so as to purposely to measure the transmission spectrum and the back there.
The polarization is kept horizontal.
This is not a stringent function.
Now here we have the
Because the commonly used substrate. For the outer ring alone, PET, BMS, they can have these two requirements.
And now, since the 2 layers are not for the inner alignment of the unit cell, is not required.
And for all these sample MR devices, they have taken all three spectrum for the
what we are mostly seeing on this device is like what we have said, they are on the inner ring. I will not go into all the technical criteria basically for these two devices.
Like we have said, especially for this
so
one,
that for their inner ring resonance intensity from the outer ring.
The spectrum actually
can see the resonance with friends.
To understand why, please relate it to the
however, if the
device is called a single device, the two gaps can see
for the
then the outer ring will have an impact
then
on the inner ring
resonance
current
and the
cause
it in color two symmetrical branches.
And for the this one device,
cross
then
horizontal
is not right incidence
and relative to branches.
The polarization is actually parallel to the inner ring.
For the double layer device,
without the outer ring,
there's no way the surface current will go dense
at just 0.8 terahertz.
It will, like we said,
the front layer is
It is only because of the parallel of the outer ring.
The current
according to the
two curve,
it has a strong resonance pattern.
Almost all
and I can fit this resonance
as a
possible resonance, so therefore it was not the case at all.
As the
to enable continuous
tuning,
this is a circular double and
more and more light base to the back.
And then
the
only
fabricated
is 5 lights
that will
demonstrate
the crossing level of the
ring.
But so in the future,
according to
the
remember,
now
we want an
actual device
where we can really
control the lower
of the
ring
that can be fabricated out.
Then for horizontally,
our current effort was
to find
its level the same way,
only
in a reverse
order. So the current
device
records
that the
front layer
tend to be
microfluidic,
and they are good
for
similar
cell
selective.
However,
the slide is
on metal activation,
and the back was open to the
back curve
for
serial
and
at high frequency.
Whereas
the
terahertz
material
cells
have been used as
biosensor.
To sum up,
these two layers
complete
in cell
complementary
quality,
and
due to their
2D
structure,
they
do not
focus
on
single cell
behavior,
and often
they
need
and
biomarker
are identical
cell complex.
But
how can we
integrate
light
with
those
that
are the same
as water
and this
structure
on
a
quite
similar
in dimension?
So what we come up is a structure like this.
To capture
now
the
cancer cell
with the
medical
structure
and
study
out of their
individual
growth
and
the key is
response.
For outer growth
and we use the MCA7
to find
a structure
to
the
isolation.
Alternating
resonance
it has
over
a
micro
size of the
cancer cell.
From
study,
which I will talk about shortly,
here
we
find that
our
double
SR
in this operation,
of course,
we still
need
where
the outer ring
and
the inner ring face
optically
to each other.
They
essentially
resonate.
So now comes
to the
end of my presentation.
So,
for
the outer ring
have
these frequencies
corresponding to
the
frequency
polarized
incidence,
and
the
inner ring
have
two resonances
at
frequencies
a little
further apart.
The
double
SR device,
they
it
inherit
all
these
four
resonances.
So
for
the
polarization
parallel
to
its gap,
it's
got
one
resonance
from
the outer
ring
and
one
from
the inner
ring,
and
so
as
for
the
polarization
across
its gap.
Now
we have
a structure
that
has
alternating
resonances
at
neighboring
frequencies
over
a non-frequency
range.
And
the
idea
is
the same,
to
pattern
it
on
both
sides of
a
substrate.
And
this
method
is
versatile.
We
can
use
different
substrates.
So
we
fabricated
the
samples
of
1 millimeter
thick
quartz
and
100
micron
thick
PET.
Now
the
PET
sample
is
so
thin,
we
can
have
both
layers
in
focus
here.
We
can
clearly
see
the
misalignment
of
the
unit
cell,
and
that
is
not
the
problem.
And this is the mirrored spectrum for both samples. We can have a stop band as large as 1.4 terahertz. Following the idea, we came up with more designs, and we particularly came up with this design to study the effect of structure symmetry. So here we have a device with symmetrical unit cell, and the one have non-symmetrical unit cell. So for the symmetric device, the results are quite as expected. So for single layered, two sharp resonances, for double layered, then we have a broadband filter. And if we look at the simulated E-field distribution, the mechanism are also like just described. At low frequencies, one layer works, at high frequency, both layers work together. Now what's more interesting is that if we examine the each entry of the Jones matrix are in the form of Tij. So what Tij means is the transmitted level of J polarized light with an I polarized incidence. And here we have, if we look at this spectrum, that's for single layered device with symmetric unit cell. We have only non-zero Txx and Tyy. That means if you have an X polarized incidence, you only get X polarized light transmitted. All the cross polarized transmission are suppressed to zero. And this is not the case. If you look at the single layer device with asymmetric unit cell, we can have a significant non-zero Txy and Tyx which overlap. That means this device is able to induce cross-polarized transmission. And another thing to note is that if we check these two resonances, the strengths are not as strong as the symmetrical device. So if we just look at the spectrum, then the structural characteristics of whether they are symmetrical, the structural characteristics, whether they are symmetrical or non-symmetrical, you can tell by just looking at the spectrum. But this is not the case for double layer device. For double layer device, for both devices, they can work as the broadband, the filter we talked about, and both of them suppress the cross-polarized transmission. So why is so? We look at the simulated E-field distribution again. Let's look at the double layer device with asymmetric unit cell. So for Y polarized incidence, that's the one vertically, like said, the front layer now, the resonance wasn't strong enough. Originally for symmetrical device, the front layer stops the light free. So now the resonance wasn't that strong. Some of the light still goes to the back. When it goes to the back, it changes its polarization to horizontal. And now the back layer would also see one that's parallel to its gap. So both layers see polarization parallel to the gap. And they work together at this resonance to stop the light. And so as for X polarized incidence at higher frequency. Next, I will talk about a simple way to fabricate PDMS device. The method is to treat a PET sample in oxygen plasma. So the charge trapped on the surface of the PET will start to repel the metal pattern on the surface. Also, the undercut of the PET will improve the transfer yield too. By bringing a PDMS substrate into contact with the treated PET sample, the metal can transfer to the PDMS surface quite easily. We don't need to put a sacrificial layer on the PET sample, nor do we need to improve the adhesion on the PDMS surface. And with this method, we tried out various patterns, big and small, gold and aluminum, and the overall yield is estimated to be over 90%. So the first thing we did with this method is to try out a PDMS broadband filter. This is from previous study. So we took two of these PET single layer device, but transferred them to both sides of a PDMS substrate, and we measured the PDMS device spectrum. Again, we got a broad stopband of as large as 1.4 terahertz. Next, we applied a very thin layer of PDMS onto some paper and a 3D. With PDMS as the medium, we were able to fabricate SRRs on all these everyday substances. We measured the transmission spectrum for this and this device, fabricated paper. And that's shown by the black and the red curve here. As for the 3D, due to the great absorptive nature of the substrate, very no transmitted signal were detected from both patterned or unpatterned 3D. So we didn't get a spectrum for this device. However, as a comparison, we transferred the same pattern onto a pure PDMS substrate, and that's shown by the blue curve here. So from this plot, we can see, except the original PET sample, all the PDMS device, they resonate at the same frequency. That is important in designing these unconventional devices. When calculating the resonant frequency, the substrate can be treated as pure PDMS. We also fabricated some 3D nanomaterial devices. We can transfer SRR patterns onto the curved surface by simply roll the PDMS cylinder or cone on the treated PET sample. And for here, we have a PDMS cube, and we can have SRR all over its six surfaces. And this might pave the way towards 3D isotropic nanomaterial devices. As for the tunable nanomaterial device, we have fabricated a series of these samples. So the double SRR all consists of the big and the small ring, but only have the inner ring rotates differently with respect to the outer ring. And to measure the transmission spectrum, the polarization is kept horizontal for all these devices. Now here we have the simulated and measured spectrum for all the device. For the outer ring alone, that's the black curve, so it has two resonances in this frequency range. And for the inner ring alone, that's the gray curve, so it has just one. And for all these double SRR devices, they have got all three resonances. What we are most interested in is this part, is this resonance from the inner ring, because it implies a possibility of tuning. I will not go into too much details of the tuning mechanism, but basically for these two devices, like we have said, especially for this one, the inner ring resonates independently from the outer ring. So we can see the resonant frequency, resonant strength are very close to just the inner ring alone. However, if the device is configured in this way, where the two gaps are close together, then the outer ring will have an impact on the inner ring's resonance and cause it to become weaker. And for this device, with a horizontally polarized incidence, then the polarization is actually parallel to the inner ring's gap. Without the outer ring, there's no way the surface current will go in this continuous fashion. It will, like we said, break into two branches. So it is only because of the presence of the outer ring, the current is forced to go in this fashion, to go in this continuous fashion. And we can treat this resonance as a forced resonance. Therefore, it is the weakest of all. To enable continuous tuning, we figured that a circular double SRR would be the best. We only fabricated these five devices to demonstrate the tuning level range. But in the future, with MEMS technology, we actual device where we can really control the rotation of the inner ring can be fabricated. Our current effort was to find biomedical applications for nanomaterial devices. So the current devices for cell studies tend to be microfluidic, and they are good for single cell study. However, they still rely on manual observation under microscope, and there is no direct platform for serial analysis. Whereas the terahertz nanomaterials, they have been used as biosensor. They can easily detect the change in cell count and morphology, but due to their 2D structure, they cannot focus on to single cell behavior, and often they need a biomarker to fix the cell in place. the how can we integrate these two? We know that this structure and this structure are quite similar in dimension. So what we come up is a structure like this to capture the cancer cell with the physical structure and study their individual growth and their drug response. We used MCF7 to do the simulation because it has a typical size of the cancer cell and it fits nicely into the trap. Here are some of our preliminary results. Of course, we still need to do more work to improve the sensitivity and actually test the device out. So now comes to the end of my presentation. Thank you for your attention.